I have said on this program that eternity is a very long time to spend in the wrong place. We'll consider that destination here in the next couple of segments with my guest, Dr. Gary Fraser. We carry his new book, Hell is for Real and Why It Matters. Eric Barger is in studio with me today as my co-host. And folks, do you know that every 60 minutes, 300 people enter into eternity? So we'll talk about that. Gary spoke at my Understanding the Times conference back in 2010 here in the Twin Cities. I'll give you contact information a little bit later. Thank you, gentlemen, for being with me today.
Thank you, Jan.
Hey, it's great to be with you again, Jan. Thank you for having me.
Gary, it's great having you back. Hey, I want to quote you here, and then let's play off of this for a few minutes. You say, why is it that in the vast majority of churches in America, the only time people ever hear about eternity is during a funeral service? Why do they never hear about hell at the morning service? And then, Gary, you go on to answer that question, and I want to discuss this. And the first reason is entertainment. In Hollywood's version of eternity, everyone goes to heaven. They never die and go to hell. Who wants to see a movie that upsets them? How many would spend $5 to $15 for a movie ticket only to be confronted with their own sin nature and the consequences it will bring? Gentlemen, this is one of the root problems in our churches today.
It really is. And let me just simply say, of course, through the entertainment world, the educational world, through cultural pluralism and so forth, political correctness and tolerance and all those kinds of things, this is a subject that's kind of taboo. Let me, if I may, address that in this way. We are living, I'm convinced, and I know that you and Eric, Jan, are as well, and that is that today we're on the verge of the threshold of the return of Jesus Christ. We're looking at God setting the world stage for his soon return. So with that as the undergirding truth, then what we are seeing happening is that Satan is really unleashing his forces, and he's attacking really what I would call the final threshold, if you please, and that is the subject matter of death. And if Satan can convince a society that in the end we're going to all just go to heaven, then he has won an incredible victory that will end up damning the souls of untold millions to an eternity. And so as a result of that, this becomes really a battleground today in the spiritual arena, because we know that we're not fighting a physical war, but this is a spiritual battle, and it's between God and Satan, and Satan is unleashing the demons of hell to try to convince people in every arena that you're really all right. And so when I saw the movie, I read the book, Heaven is for Real, when it first came out in 2009, and then when the movie came out in 2014, of course, Sandra and I went, my wife and I went and saw it, and we walked away, and I told her, I said, honey, I've got to write a book about this, because, you know, there's an underlying message. And I'm not attacking little Colton Burpo and their family, but I'm just simply saying there was an underlying message that was being communicated there that in the end, everybody's okay and we're all going to go to heaven. And that is in contradiction to what the Bible says. The great tragedy is that Jesus himself says in Matthew chapter 7, verse 13 and following, that enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction, and most people or many go that way. And he contrasts that and says, but narrow is a road that leads to eternal life, and few there are that find it. So here's the bottom line. We're not going to win the world to Jesus. But I will tell you, we're going to keep sharing our faith and being obedient, because the majority of people, according to the Word of God, are going to choose to be their own little demigod, and one day they will stand, as you referenced a little while ago, before the great white throne judgment of God, and they'll hear those words, depart from me, you who work iniquity, for I never knew you. So this subject is one that I felt impelled to address based on biblical truths, not something that would be considered an entertainment venue or even a quote-unquote secular education or cultural thing, but what does the Word of God have to say about our eternal destiny? And it's time we woke up and thought about the reality of our own mortality.
You know, Gary, the passage is quoted, too, in Matthew 7. The very next verse, verse 15, talks about wolves in sheep's clothing, and I really think that deals with people who decided to pervert, change the Word of God. And that's what I read that to be. It's very interesting that he'd talk about the narrow way, the straight way, and then, of course, the broad way that leads to destruction, and then false prophets and those who would teach something besides the truth. And I think the church has been affected by the culture and allowed hell to become a caricature instead of something that we should be concerned with, because there are fellow men around us. And instead of being an answer to the world and giving the truth about hell and about the afterlife, we seem to allow the world to lead the way instead.
Well, I think you're exactly right, Eric. And I do believe that we're in a time today where there is such a question mark over whether or not we men and women who truly been called by God to proclaim the Word of God, whether or not we're willing to boldly step up and say, thus saith the Lord, because anytime you do that, we're going to find ourselves in the same predicament Jesus was in when he began to say things that they said, well, these are hard sayings. And the majority of the people went away, and he looked to his disciples and said, are you going to go away too? And they said, to whom shall we go? Only you have the words of life. But see, the truth is, we're very success-oriented today. Church-wise, it seems so many pastors today are worried about, am I going to be a successful pastor? Am I going to be looked upon by others as having a successful ministry? Now, if you don't mind, I'll just simply share the results of a recent Barna survey, and I think it'll shed some light on what we're talking about. The Barna Group, which does wonderful research work that is so beneficial and helpful to those of us in the ministry and the world of Christendom overall, they interviewed a little over 1,000 pastors, and George Barna himself reported on this not too long ago when he said that the question they posed was, do you believe that the Bible addresses the social issues of our day? An overwhelming majority, about 97%, if my memory serves me correct, said that they believe that. And then the question was, well, do you teach your people what the Bible says about the social concerns of the issues of the day? And the overwhelming majority said no. Well, they kind of dug into that some more, and as they dug into it, they found out that the main reason most pastors shy away from issues such as hell, such as abortion, such as homosexual marriage, some of these critical issues that are right before our very faces on a daily basis, they determined that it went to how one decided or determined a successful ministry. So then they started probing, how do you see a successful ministry? What criteria do you use to measure or determine whether or not you have a successful ministry? Here was the net result, 5 things. Number 1, how many people attend my church? Number 2, how much money do people give? Number 3, how many programs do we offer our members? Number 4, how many staff members do we have on our staff? And number 5, what's the square footage of our facility? If you're listening to this and that doesn't shock you, then you're out of touch with reality. That should shock any Christ follower that would be the criteria of a successful ministry. Because if that is true, it is no wonder we're not hearing anything about hell. It's no wonder we're not taking a stand on the real social problems of our day. It also, further to that, simply says that many of the great men and women of God, such as Hudson Taylor, William Carey, I could go on and on, had unsuccessful ministries by that criteria. That's a poor way to judge whether or not we're being faithful to our calling and to the Word of God and to the Lord Jesus.
Okay. Well, Gary, I want to get to some real specific questions about hell, too. But first, I want to toss this to Eric for a minute because, I mean, we're talking here churches. The church growth movement has done a lot of damage. Eric, the emergent movement has also done some heavy damage. And I actually want to play a soundbite of Doug Padgett here in a minute. But talk to us a little bit about what the postmoderns have done.
I think the Barna survey that Gary just cited, I mean, it's spot on. It should really sound the alarm bells to us, because what's happened is we care more about church growth and about how many warm bodies are in the seats than we do about what we're teaching. Pastors are going to stand in account for what they teach and how they teach it. And I believe we're just supposed to give the message as it is in the scripture and not try to cherry pick the things that might be warm and fuzzy to people. It's not that we want to preach hell every week. It's not that we want to preach negative all the time. But the truth is the scriptures teach us about speaking to the issues of the day. The scriptures speak about these negative things. Jesus, as you pointed out in the intro, Jan, talked more about hell than he did about heaven, more about the afterlife in a negative fashion than a positive. And the truth is, no matter how many church growth gurus there have been out there that have written these books, and no matter how much the church has bent to the politically correct world today, the truth is what the scripture says is different than what we're hearing from the pulpits, yet it attracts a crowd. Probably because the people who are coming don't really know what the Bible says, so they get a perverted view of what Christianity says or is in itself. And to me, all of that is devastating to the cause of Christ. Yeah.